My name is Sinai Rusinek. I'm from the Van Leer Jerusalem Institute, a Polonsky postdoctoral fellow. Media revolutions, as my dissertation instructor, who's a classicist, told me, are a catastrophe for historians. He told me that about the late antiquity, when a very big chunk of Greek classic literature got lost in the passage from the scroll to the codex. So the main catastrophe was actually the fact that people just chose to copy only very small part of the corpus of the literature that existed at the time, and not just the burning of the library in Alexandria, as we all used to think about it. The same happened with the print revolution. Again, the choices that were made in what to preserve and what to copy, what to print out, are choices that historians today lament when they try to retrieve not only the part of the literature that was lost, but also the whole tradition, the whole tradition of reading and copying, and especially the variety of versions that the manuscripts held. Another such catastrophe was with the beginning of the press of that we are trying to sort of recover now. And Eyal Miller, who will speak later about another project in the National Library, the Historic Jewish Press, will show us one, I think, heroic attempt to salvage the Jewish part of this history of newspaper, of press, for years to come. Of course, not only a catastrophe, it is also a fascinating, media revolutions, like all revolutions, are also fascinating opportunities to rethink where we are and where we've been, because it is not until after this revolution that we begin to realize, with our new ontologies and epistemologies of knowledge, only then we begin to realize where we've been in the last media paradigm or world that we came from. So this is why a conference like this, a workshop like this on tools for researching the internet is fascinating also for me as an early modern historian, and people that study earlier eras and earlier ways of studying knowledge and archiving it and exploring it, because now we really have to start renegotiating our view of knowledge and of literatures, of concepts, ideas, on a whole new realm of virtual, cyber, internet world. Even these concepts start replacing themselves. So first, to talk today, I'm glad to invite Yoav Goldberg. Yoav is senior lecturer here at Bar-Ilan University Computer Science Department. He completed his PhD at Ben-Gurion University in 2011 under the supervision of Michael El-Khadad, Professor Michael El-Khadad. He did his postdoc as a research scientist at Google Research in New York, and he works on problems related to natural language processing and machine learning.
Hi, so I'm Yoav. I'll be speaking roughly about mining the Hebrew web, not really. So this talk is about Hebrew, and the slides are mostly in English, but all of the examples are in Hebrew. So how many of you don't speak Hebrew in the crowd? Sorry. So I guess I will switch to Hebrew at some point, and I apologize for the person who does not understand me. So the title was Mining the Hebrew Web, but actually I'm not really doing any mining of the Hebrew Web, so I talk about challenges in mining the Hebrew Web, and actually mostly about challenges in processing of Hebrew. Okay, and I will also mention some solutions that we have, and like some very small case study that I did yesterday, basically. That's kind of to show you what can be done with our tools. So I just start by talking about what makes Hebrew processing hard and some solutions. So as previously noted, I am from the CS patent here in Bar-Ilan. I work on NLP, which is basically allowing computers to understand, to some extent, some aspects of natural language, okay, such as Hebrew or English. And my focus used to be on Hebrew, then I switched to kind of the more general thing, like all languages, but now I'm back to Hebrew again. So that's about it. And when we make sense of data, we are going to somehow summarize it. So we're going to take lots of text and summarize it into a short, or into a small amount of information that we can easily digest. And that means that we're going to count something. It might be clever counting, but it will be counting nonetheless. Okay, so that's essential. And so here's an example. These are my abstracts, or some of them, kind of hard to read. And that's like a summary, so it's counted and scaled. So you can see that I like parsing and Hebrew and methods and models and words, and some other stuff like features and results and languages and stuff like that. So that was kind of the easiest thing. So we count words. What else can we count? So here are some examples. We can count word in a document. We can count word over time to see how some ideas get more or less prominent, or how words evolve. We can count certain kinds of words. So we can kind of count good or bad adjectives for sentiment, for example. We can count units which are more than words. So like Beit and Knesset mean each something else, but Beit Knesset as a unit has its own meaning, so we should kind of pay attention to that and not focus on single tokens, but like on larger units sometimes. We can look at relations between words, for example, a noun and its adjectives, or a noun and its verbs, okay? Which may not be near each other in the text, but they do share some kind of semantic information. And of course, there are many other things that we can count, okay? And actually, deciding what to count kind of is not easy, and it's the most important thing, okay? That you have to find a question that you want to answer and then figure out how to solve it, okay? What to count and how to count it correctly. But in Hebrew, counting correctly, especially counting words or counting concepts, is especially hard. Okay, so we are Hebrew, but also Chinese and Arabic and German to some extent, and many other languages are much harder than English. Okay, so English has this property that lexical units are very well separated, so each word kind of corresponds to a single unit roughly, so they do have like multi-word units, but they don't have like sub-word units, and also they don't have any inflections. And Hebrew is much, much harder, and I'll kind of show you some examples as to why is that. So basically, Hebrew is hard because we are lazy, okay? Which means that we don't write vowels, okay? So you take something like the word inherent, and it you drop the vowels, you keep the first one, and you get inherent, okay? And we can read that, but it's not in writing. Also, we don't have spaces sometimes. So here we got inherent, which is also inherent. So these two, like this token can mean two different things. So that was an example for you non-Hebrew speakers. I'll show some more examples soon. Of course, dropping spaces is really annoying. It's really hard to read and can make a lot of difference. So like here's one last English example of like what can change if you just kind of remove some space. So there is an ambiguity there, and it kind of really changes the meaning of the entire thing. And there are also other issues in Hebrew. We have flexible word order, and we have many inflections and rich morphology, but I will not discuss these in this talk at all. Okay, so no vowels. And actually, so if you look at this word, okay, which you can all read, I suppose, it means three different, or like many different things, at least three different things, okay? And they all sound the same, but they are written differently if you were to have the vowels. So it can mean like a girl, it can mean her boy, like yelda, hayelet shela, and it can mean like the verb she gave birth, okay? He yelda. So they all sound the same in Hebrew, but they have different vowels if you were to write them. But we don't, okay? Here you take this word, okay? Again, it can have several meanings. The one of them will be his arm or his hand. So it's like a noun with some possessive ending, or to be a verb. Okay, they threw rocks, okay? Or something like that. This word, particularly annoying, it could be a case marker introducing an object. It can be a pronoun, and it can be a shovel. Okay, so it's like three different, complete different usages for these two, and they're, well, two of them are really, really common. Okay, this word, again, no vowels. It can be either a book or a barber, like two different nouns. It can be a verb, he counted, and it could be he told, like in Siper. Okay, and they're all written the same. Okay, so if you just count like how many times this thing appears, it will be highly skewed and it will not be correct. Okay, and it can also kind of be in the context of a sentence. Kind of one reading would be like a sentence. So you have a barber who helped a dentist taking out denture. How do you say keter? I don't know. And the other meaning would be just a noun phrase, which is mean like a guidebook for dentists, which is published by Keter, which is a well-known publisher in Israel. Okay, so this example is due to Yael Netzer. It's a great example. Okay, so this is like completely ambiguous, this sentence, but we can have like sentences. Usually there is less ambiguity, but it's still there. One thing to note here is that we can save, we can solve this ambiguity if we had some context. So if you have these two prefixes, okay, shamati she or kaniti, just kind of like two words in the beginning will determine the meaning completely. Okay, so if you just look at the words, it's hard to say what they mean. If you have some context, you can disambiguate them quite well. Okay, and now we just move to the next problem. So up until now we talked about no vowels. Here I'll talk about no white space. Okay, so consider this word sin, China. Okay. But we can also have like two sin from, two China from China, in China, and so on. Okay? And notice there are no spaces here. And basically, an article about China may have each of these exactly once. Okay? Although China is a very main concept, appearing six times at least. Okay? So you have to kind of work below the word unit sometimes. Of course, these things can also be ambiguous, okay? So here you have some examples, okay? So the first word could be one token, which is her oil, or she got fat, or she is fat, or a fat woman. Or it could be a relativizer and then a verb, so shemana, okay? Ha'ish shemana et, whatever. The second one is really kind of all over the place. So it could be many verbs, herkavta, herkavt, okay? It could be harkavat, okay? And it could be harakevet. So again, different things, with or without white space in them. Third one, mishamayim, mashmim, mi she mine. Okay, again, the last one, mi shemash. Okay, mishmesh. Okay, mi shemesh. Many different ways. And these kind of, I pick them on purpose, but they are not that uncommon. I mean, like, if you just pick some, a Hebrew word that starts with shin, lamed, bet, mem, or you will have these kind of ambiguities in many cases. It's not a rare thing. It's really common in Hebrew. And then, like, the last sentence, so that's kind of about politics, if you want to say. So you have Habayit HaYehudi, and you want to count this event, like how many times do people talk about this? Okay, so that's kind of easy, two words, you know, and they'll be always together. But then, okay, so you can have Me Habayit HaYehudi and Ume Habayit HaYehudi, okay? And that's also kind of easy, you just kind of drop the prefix. But then what happens here is that for some reason this hey in the beginning disappeared after Bet or Alamed, okay? So this still means Habayit HaYehudi, or Le Habayit HaYehudi, but you don't see that, okay? So there are elements which are just hidden in text, which also makes it kind of harder to kind of identify this event correctly. Okay, names are also kind of problematic. We don't use the English orthography, so we have to take names and transfer them into Hebrew. And there are many ways of doing that. Okay, so like Michael or Michael, Abbas, it's kind of like wherever, you can really go all over the place. And like many other names, if it's kind of from some foreign origin, it will be really hard to find like one way to write that. So you can refer to the same entity in many different names. So these are kind of from the news. I used to do some project on medical Hebrew, and there with drug names, it's really much worse even. Okay, so there are like many ways to write the same name of some chemical element or a drug, and it's kind of really hard to identify. We do have some solutions for that, but I will not talk about them, but just know that they do exist to some level. And of course, also we have no capitalization, so we don't indicate proper names with kind of nice marker as they do in English. So it's hard to identify, and they're also kind of ambiguous. You can, like words like Chaim or Oren or Israel are kind of ambiguous between a name and something else. Okay, so enough about the problems. Let's talk about some tools. First, we have a tool. Okay, now when I say a tool, I mean we have a program that can do this. It's not packaged nicely, and it's not very nice to use as an end user. But if you talk to me, I can kind of help you out. And at some point, we may package them nicer, but just like it's not our focus. We just kind of want to develop them and hope people to use them. But we don't have like this middle link of like making them easy to use or easy enough to use. But if you have something in mind, just talk to me, and I'll try to help you out with this particular thing, or if you have some budget, you can kind of work together on making it nicer, but I don't have like a budget or students for this right now. So tagging and segmentation, this was primarily done by Manny Adler in Ben Gurion as part of his PhD work. I also kind of had some parts in that. So we can perform tagging and segmentation quite nicely in context with relatively high accuracy. Of course, there will be mistakes occasionally because we are not perfect and we are far from it, and it's all statistical and it's hard, but it does work pretty well. Let me show you an example. So let's close this guy. So here I had this thing from Ynet yesterday, which I just plugged into our software, and I got this response. Ignore the colors, okay? They are not that great. So actually, the blue background means like NP units, which are actually quite good. The red and blue stuff, just ignore that. But if you work on a word here, you see that this thing is a noun, and it is definite. Okay, so you can see that. Chef Seed, you can see this segmentation. L'Americani, so you have this. That's a nice one. Kshelet Sido, and on side of him, basically. Okay, Obama, proper name. That's a mistake here. He didn't do this one correctly. But mostly it did most of them quite well, which is nice. Okay, so we have this tool. It's on the web. You can just plug in a sentence and read that. But if you want to process more than one sentence, talk to me and we'll try to figure something out. And that's pretty useful. I mean, again, it's not perfect, but it helps a lot. So you can now distinguish between Sefer and Safar and Siper and Safar. Okay, so it's nouns and verbs. You can easily distinguish. Okay, go back to the presentation. Something else we can do is syntax. That's my work primarily. So basically, you take a sentence, such as this one, which appeared in some newspaper, okay? And you break it down into a syntax tree, okay? Which basically, it's units in which each word modifies a different word. I will not get into the details of that, okay? But this is kind of, will give you a high-level structure of the sentence, okay? It is much more complex than the previous problem, and it's less accurate, but it still is quite accurate, and it works pretty well. And let me just show you what you can do with that, like some examples. So just yesterday, I did this kind of quick case study to kind of like have a nice example from the politic domain. I don't know how to do it, really, but I tried to do something, which is kind of sort of amusing. So I went to this website of Arut Sheva, which is a newspaper. I chose it because it was really easy to download from it, okay? So like no other bias, it's like easy to download, much nicer than Ynet in this respect, okay? And I took several thousand recent news items, okay, like from yesterday backwards, basically. So it's about 2.5 million tokens, which is kind of smallish. I mean, it's really kind of tiny, but I did that in like a couple of hours, the entire thing, so. That's kind of like a small thing you can do. And then I kind of ran it through our system and I parsed it, and then I extracted simple NPs, okay? Like simple noun phrases. I will not get into the definitions, but basically noun phrases without recursion in them and without prepositions in them. So the most frequent ones, okay, are this one. So Israel, he's saying, Pid, Yedei, Yerushalayim, Makom, and so on. So they are kind of not very exciting, but one thing to note here, but they do give you kind of a feel of what this thing is mostly about, okay? Israel, basically, and army, and Jerusalem, and Netanyahu. One thing to note here is this guy, okay? So that's more than one word, okay? So it found this two-word unit, which is nice. Okay, now I'll just kind of show you some other multiple word units that it found on its own, because like it didn't know this concept, but because of the structure, it kind of identified them, and there are many more down the list, but like these are the frequent ones with more than one word. So you can see Eretz Israel, Bet Mishpat, Retzuat Aza, Tel Aviv, and so on. Okay, so you do get kind of naturally occurring multi-word units, and it kind of decide that this thing is an entity, okay, and it should be, and it's kind of have its own meaning. It might be decomposable, but this has its own, it's its own thing, okay. Then I kind of looked at the NPs that contain the word Netanyahu or Bennett, so you can kind of see how people refer to them. So Netanyahu and Bennett are primarily referred to by their last name, but they can also be referred to by their titles, okay, or by their full name. And you can see that Bennett is mostly referred to as Bennett, but then and as his like first and last name, Naftali Bennett, and only then as the chairman of whatever or as the minister of whatever, while Netanyahu is firstly Rosh HaMemshala, and then Rosh HaMemshala Netanyahu, and then you find his full name, okay? So, I'm not sure like how interesting it is, but you can kind of see that from the text. Same here for Yechimovich, okay? So you can kind of have all of your titles, basically nicely done. Okay, so that's about simple NPs with people names in them. Then I kind of look to see like NPs with the word Kitzoni in them. So you get that Kitsuni is mostly to the left, some Kitsuni is to the right. Then I looked for Matun, like basically nothing with Matun. Then I kind of said, okay, so I'll have like Metuna and Metunim as well. And you get some kind of Metinut, somewhat to the right, somewhat, yeah, okay. So the next thing I looked at is subject-verb relations. Okay, so basically I took some entities, the ones from before that had Netanyahu and Bennett and all of those in them, and see which verbs are the subjects of. Okay, so what do these things do in the text? And that's are the most frequent ones. Okay, so they all say things, and they all mitichsim, and they all mosifim, and so on. So let's kind of agree out the one that they all do. Okay, now that's kind of nice. You can see that Netanyahu and Lapid make decisions. Bennett and Lapid are writing much more than the others. Okay, blogs and Facebook and so on, I suppose. And then Netanyahu nifgash, only he did that. Bennett kara, Lapid evtiach, and even takaf, which is kind of, you know, and some of these also appear kind of down below in the text, like for others, like Lapid also has takaf, but it's much less common than the others, okay? So kind of you can see some kind of, it's not really like scientific, but you can see some insight, at least for this paper about that. If you look at Galon, she also says things, but she has kind of much more diversity of, so she is mentioned much less, but she has much more diversity of actions, basically. And there are many other ones at the end that I didn't include. Okay, so that was about syntax. Now I'll just kind of briefly talk about topic modeling, which is some other technique which we can do. So in a nutshell, it's a process that will take a collection of documents, say these articles from Arut Sheva, and it will divide them into topics, where each topic is a distribution of a word. Basically, it means it's a collection of words. And the algorithm will find this topic on its own, okay? And it will not give it a name, but it will kind of show you what are the main words for this topic, and then you can kind of figure out what this is. Okay, so I don't have time to get into the details, but basically you can think that like words belong to topics and then topics belong to documents. Okay, so what you can do with that is kind of have this exploration of like what is this document collection about, like what are the main topics here. You can find similar documents to a given one, and you can find a document with some topic in it, okay? And you can also kind of plot topics over time, which is nice. Okay. So let's give you like a very quick example. Here is the list of topics that we found in this news articles from Arut Sheva. Okay, so each row here is one topic which is kind of characterized by its main words. So you can see like the first one is clearly about security. Okay, then you can have like this one, which is about police and imprisonment and stuff like that. This one is about like legislation. So these are the main words. This is kind of like municipal, this kind of archaeology or things like that. If I'll hover over this word here, for example, you can see that's like that this makom is actually bemakom, lemakom, imakom, hamakom, bemkomot, and so on. So kind of it's reflected there. And there are like many other words like down below the list. It's a long list. It has 100 topics. That's what I told him to find 100 topics, so it found 100 topics. Okay. So you can have like this is like Palestinian issues. This is about communication, and so on. And if you click one of them, you will get like a list of articles. Slowly. About this topic. Okay, or like. Not about that, like that this topic was kind of was reflected in them. They had words from this topic. Okay, so that's kind of a nice tool. It can be, it can do more than that, but I don't have time, so I'll go back to the conclusion. Okay, so basically, working with Hebrew is hard. We need to do some pre-processing, but we have some tools for that, so that's good. We can look beyond the word level using syntax or topic modeling, like what appears together. Now, I'm not really good at asking good questions about the text. I mean, that's what you guys do. I just kind of do the programming behind and kind of have this algorithm. But if you have a good question, I have the tools that may help you answer it correctly. So it would be nice if you can talk. Unfortunately, I'll be leaving quite early today because there is this other conference in the Tech Union about big data, and I also want to be there. But I will be here in the next break, and maybe slightly after that. So if you can, and maybe on Thursday, but I'm not sure. So do approach me either by email or personally. I'll be happy to talk to you. Thanks.